All right, joining us in Hot Copy, una senatorial candidate, Cagayan 1st District Representative Jack Ponce Enrile is with us this morning. Good morning to you, Jack. Thank you for coming to the show.
Good morning. Thank you.
All right, so how have you been?
Good, actually. Good. Thank you very much.
All right, let's start with this. You first started your senatorial survey. You were at number 5. And then you were at 5 or something.
Eight.
You were always at 8?
At 8.
Because right now you are
December 2011, we were at 8.
You were at 8. Mm-hmm. And now you are at 9 or 10?
8 or 9.
8 or 9. Mm-hmm. So, because people have been saying that you were very high. I've seen surveys where you were 5.
Mm-hmm.
And then you went down to 9. And mm-hmm. people were saying it's because voters now know that it wasn't the father running.
Well, the interesting thing, if you track the SWS surveys over the last 3 surveys,
okay.
In August, the percentage that I got was 48, and I think I was placing around 6th at the time.
Okay.
And then the last one was, I was at 46, and I think I was around the same one. And today, the latest SWS survey, I'm still at 46. And the difference between number 5, number 6 is actually 2 points.
Okay.
So I've been holding at 46.
You've been holding?
I've been holding at 46, despite the fact that I was the one who filed in October 1st, and my advocacy ads has been coming out, and I've been coming out in other news programs as well. So that basically, the percentage of people who at that point, would actually consider me as a candidate and vote for me still has actually been maintained.
All right, let's be honest. If your father was not so popular during the impeachment trial, would you have chosen to run?
I started considering this as I was starting to go around the country pushing for House Bill 4626.
Okay. Ito ang kasambahay bill.
No, this is the
Food for Filipinos First Act.
So we, in a series of consultations, of which we've done about 95 already, all over the country in 75 provinces.
Okay.
We've been getting encouraging comments from farmer sectors, fisher sectors. So after about a year of going around, then we probably started to consider the possibility. But there was really no, when the decision was made to perhaps look into this, there was no survey yet, and there was no impeachment yet.
Okay.
So we made the decision even before the start.
Come on, is that true?
Yeah, but we started this process December of 2010.
But what must have sealed the deal was at some point your father's high popularity ratings.
Well, obviously it helps, Karen. But whether or not we were going to get the kind of popularity rating that we're enjoying now, we were going to pursue it. In fact, truth be told, the entire team that I put together, we did not even expect to be in the top 25 in the first survey.
Okay.
And we were willing to work our way up. So thank God that now that people know it's me, we've been holding.
Okay.
Now, I don't know what the latest SWS survey was conducted already after all the controversy happened.
Okay.
So right. I don't know how that's going to affect the future surveys, but you know, I'll take what I can get.
Okay, let's get down to business. Now, why vote for you? You were in Congress, and I think you should answer this, is you are number 9 of the top absentee mm-hmm. congressmen.
Mm-hmm.
In this listing, you were present only 30 days mm-hmm. of 59 days.
Mm-hmm.
That's 59 session days.
Mm-hmm.
And Juan Ponce Enrile Jr. was only present 30 days, which means you were absent 29 days.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I mean, thank God that you're not worse than Ruben Ecleo, was only present 8 days. But
mm-hmm.
why should they vote for you when you were absent most of the time?
Well, I don't think that a congressman's only job is to wear a nice suit and go to Congress and get part of the roll call. Part of the work of legislation really is consultation. In fact, that's my style of doing business.
Okay.
I am more effective when I meet the people firsthand, go see the conditions on the ground, and get the inputs from the people. And that's basically the process that we undertook when we made the decision that for the 15th Congress, the advocacy of Jack Enrile was really going to be agriculture. And in the process, we had to conduct several consultations mm-hmm. nationwide.
And did you have a committee? Did you have a committee when you were in the House?
I never asked for a chairmanship of any committee. I only joined four committees. I joined as a member the Committee on Appropriations, Accounts, Ways and Means, and Agriculture, because I really wanted to focus on this food sovereignty bill. So when I decided to do this, after studying it, we decided to go on the road. And basically, it's very difficult for a congressman to actually be on the field and at the same time, on the same day, be in Congress, because it takes me to places like Mindanao. You know, I've been to every province in Mindanao. I've been to every province in the Visayas and most of the provinces in Luzon.
So yung mga sinasabi na, absent naman si Jack Enrile.
Pero nasa field at nagtatrabaho.
Sinasabi nila, hindi yun pumapasok. Tamad yun sa Kongreso, hindi naman performer.
Iba naman yung actual legislation, yung nagsusulat ka. Iba yung nagre-research ka at nagsusulat ka. At humihingi ka ng input sa ibang tao. At ini-explica mo yung magiging impact ng isang panukalang batas kung sakaling may isang batas natin ito. Ngayon, Karen, aminin na natin na sa Kongreso, kapag hindi napapakinggan ng mga kasama natin sa Kongreso ang tungkol sa isang issue, they tend not to mind it. So, as more and more people are involved, as the people in their districts start talking about a particular issue, in this case, agriculture and food sovereignty as it pertains to agriculture, then when it comes to the plenary, they are more likely to support that particular measure.
Okay.
So the roadshow was very, very important for the bill.
Okay, we're going to talk about the bills later on. Now, I think one of your challenges running is the fact that your reputation actually precedes you.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, frankly speaking.
Rightly or wrongly.
Rightly or wrongly. And they say you're a changed man now at 54?
54.
You're 54. Now, the question is, I've been doing research last night. I'm going to read this and you can correct me as we go along. In a span of 6 years in the mid-70s, your name got entangled with three murders.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. First one, 1975, when you were only 17 years old. This was in the book of your father, in his memoir. You were involved in the death of the son of an ex-military officer, Ernest Robert Lucas, during a soiree in Bel Air.
The son of Commodore Lucas.
What happened there? The boy died?
The boy died. Unfortunately, it was an unfortunate event. It was a series of events that led up to that particular point. He had come early with a group of friends trying to enter the party, which was a soiree.
Yeah.
So one class of males, one class of females.
And you were Ateneo.
I was Ateneo.
Yeah, because
high
you
school.
Had said it was an Ateneo soiree.
Ateneo High School with St. Paul's. So it was the class of my girlfriend and my class.
Okay.
Basically, when Ernest came in, he wanted to come in with his friends. To basically join
the soiree.
Well, babysit his sister who was in attendance. And I said, Ernest, ikaw okay lang. Pero yung mga kaibigan mo, hindi pwede dahil it's a class party. I hope you understand. So sabi niya, we'll just come back. So after about a couple of hours, 3 hours, they came back and I think they were a little inebriated. And they proceeded to make a little bit of noise with their cars in front of the house. Which sort of, you know, as teenagers, some of my classmates started to go outside. I was eating inside with my then girlfriend, and I said, "What's all this ruckus?" And the, you know, tires were squealing. How teenagers are.
Yeah.
And then they proceeded to park at the far end, and of course, alam mo, yung mga batang teenager nagkakapormahan. They started screaming some things, and my classmates started screaming. And then, so my girlfriend at the time said, Jack, tingnan mo ko anong problema. So I said, Sunny, one of my classmates, halika, samahan mo ako. So we proceeded. And when we proceeded to approach Ernest, it was nice. I mean, Ernest, you know, konting yun lang, maiinit yung mga kaklase ko. And I think at that point, he was a little drunk. Now, I did not know that the only bodyguard that I had at that time was following me. He was eating inside.
Yes, this is Danilo.
Danilo Lim.
Danilo Lim.
Danilo Lim.
But not the Danilo Lim now.
No, not Danilo Lim now. Danilo Lim from Cavite.
Yeah.
Mm-mm. He was my security personnel at the time assigned to me. Iisa lang yan. And I guess when he found out that I was outside and he was eating inside.
He followed you.
He followed me. Yes. I did not know. And Ernest and I began to talk to one another. There was really no heated argument. But I think when he jumped out of the hood of the car, he was seated on the hood of the car, Danny put himself between me and him. There were four of them, and there were basically Sunny and I. I did not know that Danny was behind me. And Danny put himself between me and him, and something just popped. And then all of a sudden, Danny stepped back, and then I saw blood on myself.
So Danny killed him?
Well, Danny shot him.
Was it intentional?
No, I don't think so. I think it was accidental.
So he accidentally cocked his gun?
I think at that time, you know, the firearms practices were kind of primitive at the time, to say the least. They didn't know gun safety was not a big factor. And I think the gun went off. And subsequently, Danny was tried and he served time.
Yeah. So is he out now?
Because he's dead.
Oh, he's
dead. He died of cancer a few years ago.
So he's dead, but you were cleared.
I was cleared. Yeah. I undertook paraffin tests.
Yes.
The NBI conducted the investigation and I was cleared.
All right. Now, clearly you were not carrying a gun that night.
No.
Okay. But the reputation of Jack and Rile of the old, when you were very young, is your bodyguards seem to be trigger happy.
Yeah, and that's the reason why we needed to professionalize. And basically, that was the contribution of then Major Onasan to the security group.
Yeah.
And essentially, we upgraded the professionalism of the security team.
But some of the things I heard was, if Jack and Rile were not arrogant, why would his bodyguards be more arrogant than he was?
I don't know how to answer that. You know, my father had always taught us to be humble and friendly. And obviously, when you're under the limelight and you're under the microscope, anything you do can be considered arrogant.
Okay.
Even just by, you know, I would get comments, Karen, you know, that my walking by somebody without necessarily acknowledging it, and I probably could have been thinking of something else, I was considered arrogant already.
All right. The second one is the killing of Ricardo Manala Jr., president and general manager of Manala Trucking Company, mm-hmm. killed at Stargazer Disco in Silangis Hotel. My God, nakapunta pa ako dito. In June of 1981, your bodyguard had shot Ricardo 5 times for allegedly stepping on your foot.
That was not true.
Okay, what really happened
that
there?
That was not true. Actually, I was in the bathroom.
Okay.
And the next person on the stall in the bathroom was Ricky Rason. And he in fact, was the witness. Ricky Rason of
ICTSI. Yeah.
And he and I were talking, you know, doing our thing. And says, "Oh, Ricky, I had not seen you in 10 years. How are you doing?" And then during the course of that conversation, there was just some gunshots. And Ricky actually proceeded to pull me and him and put both of us inside the stall and says, "They're shooting."
And I go, "So you were in the bathroom?"
I was in the bathroom.
You're not outside?
No, I was not outside. So all these urban stories started to swirl all over. And one thing led to another and things started to get exaggerated, stories started to be told, and you know, basically the reputation evolved.
Yeah, so why did your bodyguard shoot him?
I don't know. I actually don't know. I think...
Did you ask
him? He was drunk at the time.
Your bodyguard?
Yes.
Did you fire him?
Yes. He went to jail.
He went to jail.
He was convicted.
Now, I mean, having two bodyguards to go to jail, this doesn't look good.
Exactly, exactly, exactly right. And that is why we have been as a family very, very careful in whom we hire.
Okay.
And we have set parameters as to how they should behave, how they should dress, how they should even conduct themselves in public. And if people notice, there's very few people that are actually going around with us right now.
An incident took place in 1980, involved the shooting of a certain Santillan who refused to move his Jeep that was blocking your car. In all the three cases, your paranoid bodyguard shot the victims when their boy appeared, when you appeared to be threatened. This was, I'm quoting from Yoli Ong's column. And the question is, do you even remember this Santillan who owned the Jeep?
I actually left already the place that was supposed to have happened.
But you heard it?
I was there, but I had actually left, and I only found out much later.
Okay.
Much later.
The reason I'm asking this is if you run for the Senate and win, people might be saying, my God, baka mamaya pag naka-block lang yung kotse ko sa Jeep ni Jack Enrile, mamatay na ako.
Well, to be quite honest, I am saddened that those things actually did happen. We have undertaken severe and serious steps to make sure that our security details are actually professionalized. And if you notice that over the course of the last 30 years, there has been no incidents.
Okay. All right. Now, there was another one wherein you supposedly broke into a party. This is like serious research from people must be your age. I'm much younger than you, so I didn't party with you. Broke into a party in September. It must be of 1982 also. And your bodyguards were tagged by the police as the suspected killers of two Philippine Navy men. You encountered them in a car park.
That's the first time I hear
not
this.
Not that.
I don't know anything about
okay,
that.
But you can imagine how things have gone around.
Exactly.
Okay.
I mean, I think you know, these stories start to feed on themselves.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So you are admitting three instances of which the Jeep, you were not there.
Mm-hmm.
But do you admit that your bodyguard killed the jeepney driver?
No. I don't even know which bodyguard that was.
Okay. But the two, you do know they were involved.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Now, the most controversial, you've been asked this quite often, is the death of Alfie Enido.
Yes.
Okay. You were there.
I arrived.
Tell me the story.
I arrived. I was having dinner with then Colonel Onasan.
Okay.
I was home for vacation from the States. It was, I believe, Christmas break. And he and I were eating in this Eat All You Can Miyako.
Okay.
In Pasay Road.
Yes,
in
yes.
Pasay, close to Dusit Hotel. So we were having dinner there and we were just catching up and how are you doing? And we heard a squelch on the radio saying that Katrina was riding in Alfie's car. They were traveling at a fast rate from Antipolo towards Makati.
Yeah. Were they fighting?
I don't know. I did not know at that time. I knew much later. Okay, later on. I did not know at the time, and I said, well, they're probably just going home. And I think it was Alfie's birthday.
Okay.
And a few minutes later, they had arrived in Alfie's house, and everything was supposed to have been normal. So Greg and I proceeded to eat. And
this is now Senator Greg Onasan,
yes.
Just for our viewers.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then we decided to continue with our dinner,
yeah.
You know, eating, sharing tempura.
Yeah, and let's explain, he was detailed to your father.
He was the security officer.
Exactly.
Detailed to my father. He basically, after his stint in Mindanao, spent the rest of his military career as a security aide and aide-de-camp of my father.
Okay.
And so he was in charge of the security of my father and my father's family. And after about a few minutes, he rose up and he says, I have to go. And I go, what's going on? I said, there's something that happened with Katrina. So I said, where's that? In Alfie's house.
Okay.
So out of concern and curiosity, I told him, sama ako. So we proceeded.
So it was Greg Onasan who said, I have to go.
He
said.
Yes.
Okay, because he heard on the radio.
Yes.
So did Katrina have a bodyguard then?
Yes.
She did.
Yes.
So the bodyguard was the one who had reported to Greg.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. So we proceeded to Bel Air. I forget exactly the address. We proceeded to Bel Air, and the house was open. The gate was open, I remember. The door was open. There were lights inside. And when I entered the threshold of the house, I saw Babita, the sister of Alfie, and asked, where's Katrina? At that point, immediately after asking her that, I heard Katrina screaming and crying. And when I looked at her, she said, Alfie, si Alfie. So I looked inside the room where Alfie was supposed to have been, and I saw a gun. So I recoiled. I moved.
Where did you see the gun?
It was on the floor, I think it was.
What kind of a gun?
It looked like a .45 at that time. And then I looked again inside, and I looked inside, and I peered through. I saw Alfie's face was already swollen. Now, it was already swollen, and there was a bullet hole already in his head. And, you know, the unfortunate thing was my friend shot himself. Alfie was my friend. Even before he knew Katrina, he was my friend. He was a year, I think, below me in Ateneo. We were friends since grade school. And it was an unfortunate thing. And I don't know the reason or what motivated him to do what he did. I was told that Katrina was trying to break it off with him already that day. And it was unfortunate that Alfie took his own life.
Okay, so the gun was not yours?
Gun was not mine.
It was not Greg Onassad's?
It was not Greg Onassad's. I don't know whose gun it was.
But it clearly is in Alfie's house.
Yes. He probably had one.
Was he a shooter?
It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter whether he was an active shooter or not, or whether he was a competitor or not. People had guns.
Okay.
You know, people have had guns in their homes for since, you know, World War II or even before that.
Now, Jack, you know that your father wrote about this in his book, but then your account and your father's account is not the same.
Yeah, my account is actual. I was actually there.
Yeah, your father said you were never there.
He probably did not know. He probably did not know. He was probably trying to recall. You know, these memoirs, he started writing these memoirs, I think, in 2002. Roughly 20 years after. And he was at that time, he'll be 89 now, so he was 79.
Yeah.
So memories tend not to be fresh.
Now, do you know what's gone around?
But for me, these things actually happened to me, so I know.
What's gone around is that, forgive us because, of course, Alfie has passed away, but for news purposes, I need to mention this, is that he was allegedly beating up Katrina and that you came in her defense.
Katrina never told me any instance wherein Alfie hurt her. She never told me anything.
Now, how do you live with this, that you are blamed for Alfie Anido's death?
Very painfully. You know, I have been trying to answer an allegation that was not true for over 30 years. It's not been easy. It's been actually difficult. And, you know, when you think that you're already way past it, you know, people bring these things up and they embellish it.
Yeah.
And it takes a life on of its own. And no matter what you do, you know, they say, oh, how come you've been quiet all this time? Well, I tried to tell people that I had nothing to do with it, but it's physically impossible for someone like me to go to each and every person and explain what had happened. And, you know, I take this opportunity. And every time that somebody asks me in the media what it is, I take the opportunity to explain because the reach is much greater. But it's impossible for somebody like me. And, you know, this thing has been hounding me for 30 years, something that never actually happened the way people thought it was.
You've been accused as a killer.
Yes.
You've been called a bully.
Yes.
Arrogant. Yes. Everything.
Yes. I've been called everything. Do you think I'm that?
Well, I didn't know you then. Mm-hmm. Okay. I wanted to ask you this. You've been born again.
Since 84.
Yes, 84. So all of this, in a span of 6 years, happened in the early 80s. In 1984, you became a born-again Christian. Mm-hmm. Many people don't know this too.
Yeah. Well, it's not something that you want to advertise, I guess, or, you know, a personal relationship with Jesus Christ is exactly that. It's personal.
Okay, how have you changed?
Well, I believe in the God of the Bible.
Okay.
I choose to believe in the God of the Bible, and it has worked for my life. How have I changed? I'm now a better person, I guess. A better father, certainly. A better husband.
Okay.
A better son.
Mm-mm.
And a better friend, I would like to think, to those people that know me. That is the extent, basically, of my exposure. I'm not the type of person, Karen, that goes out there and say, oh, you know, like me because I'm born again.
Yeah.
Not too many people know.
Okay.
But I have tried to live the life of a man of faith. And basically, I leave it up to God. You know, whatever happens to me, you know, from that point on up till the day that God decides to take me, He is in total control.
Okay. Now, what do you admire, very quickly, because we don't have enough time, but what do you admire from your father? One word.
His doggedness.
Doggedness.
His determination.
What don't you want to copy from your father?
His emotionality.
Your father is emotional.
Very emotional.
Okay. In his book, he said that he believed what he regretted was he didn't spend enough time with his wife, your mom, and his two kids because he was always at work.
And in my case, I tried to make up for that with my own children.
Okay.
Because I did not want my children to say the same thing about me.
Now, masama ba loob mo sa tatay mo for a long time?
For a long time, he and I were not actually talking.
Yes, you only made peace in 2006.
We made peace after quite a big blow up in the late 1990s, early 2000s, yes.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Now, what made you make peace?
Age.
What, did you hug him?
Yeah, oh yeah.
You said sorry? What happened?
He said sorry. We both cried.
Really?
He was crying for an hour and a half.
Your dad?
He was crying for an hour.
Miriam can't even make him cry. Yeah. No, I'm kidding.
I'll whisper to Senator Miriam and I'll show him the secrets.
Seriously? Yeah. He was crying for an hour and a half, and that changed it.
I think the acceptance of how he treated me in the past and how I behaved as a son to him in the past, when we buried the hatchet, I think it created the opportunity for us to go down this path that we're going down now.
Okay.
Which is basically a path where we are really father and son. And that, you know, he's not just a father in name and because I came from him biologically, but I am his son and he is my father.
All right. What's interesting, before we go to a quick break, because we'll move on to other things like your performance, what you think of how your dad's recent, he saw the headlines, how it affects you. But very quickly, you voted pro-RH bill, and your dad was so against the RH bill, although he did not filibuster. I mean, that's what many said. He just really registered his opposition to the RH bill. Now, did your dad at any point tell you, Jack, you cannot vote for the RH bill, the truth?
No, he never said that. You cannot vote.
What did he say?
He said, these are the points, and I made my points. And actually, we were talking up to about 10 o'clock at night before the voting. And I was trying to convince him to vote my way, and he was trying to convince me to vote his way. But he never said, vote this or else. And, my father has been consistent in that respect most of our lives. He has allowed us to make our own decisions, both Katrina and I. Both him and my mother have given us the opportunity to seek our own paths, whether we make mistakes or not, whether the decisions we make were right or not. They allowed us to do so.